Welcome. Now we will discuss DC dynamic braking of three-phase induction motor. Dynamic braking means it is also another name is rheostatic braking. So I will tell the salient points. While motoring, the stator magnetic field rotates at synchronous speed, which is omega s, in the same direction as that of rotor, but slightly faster. Here r is missing in faster. The relative speed with respect to rotor is slip times the synchronous speed, slightly faster than rotor conductors. For DC dynamic braking, stator winding is disconnected from the AC supply and fed with DC. So the magnetic field produced is stationary in space. So magnetic field is stationary in space and rotor is rotating at its speed just before braking. So the rotor moves past the stationary magnetic field at a speed. So initial motor speed was omega m. So omega m, that which is 1 minus slip times the synchronous speed, and let us write capital S times the synchronous speed. So during motoring, the magnetic field moves ahead the rotor, but during braking, the rotor is moving, magnetic field is stationary. So the relative speed direction has reversed. Magnitude is given by capital S omega S, and direction of relative speed also it has reversed. The result is EMF induced in rotor winding is of opposite polarity compared to motoring case. So currents induced in the rotor circuit is opposite in direction to that for motoring, producing a braking torque, because the direction of current has reversed, relative speed has reversed. So as current direction has reversed, it produces a braking torque. So during motoring, when the rotor is stationary, that means just at the beginning of the starting, the rotor is stationary and magnetic field rotates at synchronous speed omega s. So during that time, frequency of rotor current, that is F2, which is p relative speed is omega s by 4 pi. P is the number of poles, omega s is the synchronous speed, that is the relative speed when the rotor is rotating, and that is equal to f, that is the supply frequency. During dynamic braking, magnetic field is stationary and rotor rotates at speed omega m, because that was the speed of the rotor. So frequency of rotor current, which we denote as F2, that is p relative speed is omega m divided by 4 pi. So that is s times p omega s by 4 pi, because omega m is capital S times omega s. So that is S times the supply frequency. So during, as the process is braking, the torque is opposite to rotor speed. So speed reduces starting from omega m to 0. So frequency decreases to 0 with speed. frequency decreases with rotor speed to final value of 0. So, next again we will consider the motoring case, when the rotor is stationary, that means it is just at the time, just before starting, just before rotor starts rotation, and magnetic field rotates at synchronous speed. Magnitude of rotor induced EMF is E2, which is also equal to E1. Assuming unity turns ratio, otherwise E2 dash equal to E1. During DC dynamic braking, when the magnetic field is stationary and rotor rotates at speed omega m, magnitude of rotor induced EMF referred to stator is omega m by omega s times the E2 dash, that is s times the E2 dash, because omega m by omega s is capital S, so that is also equal to s times the stator induced EMF SE1. The condition in rotor during DC dynamic braking, when the speed decreases from omega m to 0, is the same as when the rotor accelerates from rest to omega m during motoring. So, rotor equivalent circuit is similar to motoring case. Motoring case with capital S replacing the slip small s. Next, we will do the equivalent circuit analysis. Equivalent circuit for DC dynamic braking. This is the rotor resistance R2. This is rotor reactance SX2, because slip, the now capital S times the supply frequency is the rotor frequency. At rotor frequency, supply frequency is F, rotor reactance is X2. Now, the rotor frequency is capital S times the supply frequency. So, rotor reactance is SX2, and the EMF is SE2, that is also SE1. Assuming unity turns ratio, and this is the rotor current I2, this is the rotor circuit. So, this is, if you may draw an equivalent circuit. So, let us divide the reactance SX2 by capital S and refer it to stator side. So, this is X2 dash. Similarly, R2 is divided by the same value and refer to stator. So, now this is R2 dash by S, and current I2 dash should be the same I2 dash. And so, this reactance becomes E2, the induced EMF is E2 dash, that is E1. So, this is the rotor circuit referred to stator. So, now this leads to the total complete equivalent circuit. This is R2 dash by S. This is a rotor reactance referred to stator X2 dash. This is the current I2 dash. This is the magnetizing reactance XM, and this is the current IM, and this is the stator current I1, and here EMF is E1. So, from the above equivalent circuit, equivalent AC stator current I1, which is a phasor, is obtained as I2 dash, that is the rotor current referred to stator, plus magnetizing current. So, this is a phasor addition. So, this is equivalent alter AC I1. So, So from the equivalent circuit, we can obtain the braking torque. Braking torque is TB. So braking torque represents the power in the rotor resistance R2 dash by S. So braking torque is 3 by omega S into current I2 dash square into R2 dash by S. Unit is Newton meter. And what is I2 dash? I2 dash is in terms of tetra current I1, and using the equivalent circuit, it is Xm divided by R2 dash by S square plus Xm plus 2 dash square root over. This is I2 dash. Then for braking torque to be maximum, what is the condition? You can write dTb by dS equals to 0 and solve for S, or you can apply maximum power transfer theorem, because R2, when the power in the resistance R2 dash by S is maximum, the torque is also maximum. So corresponding to this condition is R2 dash by Sm, Sm is the value of capital S corresponding to braking, maximum braking torque. This is Xm plus X2 dash. So maximum braking torque occurs at speed Sm times omega S, where Sm is R2 dash divided by Xm plus X2 dash. And the maximum braking torque that can be obtained, TB max, that is given by, you can substitute this value Sm in the expression and you can complete the derivation. It is, the result is 3 by 2 omega S I1 square Xm square divided by Xm plus X2 dash. So looking at the expression for the maximum braking torque, you can conclude the maximum braking torque depends upon the stator current I1, depends on the stator current I1, but independent of rotor resistance R2. But rotor resistance R2 decides the speed at which the maximum braking torque can occur. So next we will draw the characteristics for the braking, torque speed characteristics, speed versus so x axis is the electromagnetic torque. So for braking action, torque is negative. So this is for one value of current and rotor resistance, and if the rotor resistance is increased at this current, then the characteristics will be like this, modified. And if the initial value of the rotor resistance, the braking, the stator current is increased, the resistance will is increased, it is like this. So similarly, in the opposite side also, so you can say this is for DC dynamic braking, and this one is a for a stator current I1 and rotor resistance R2 dash, and this one is for the same stator current I1 with another value of rotor resistance R2 double dash, and R2 double dash is greater than R2 dash, and this one is for the stator current I1 dash and same rotor resistance R2 dash, where I1 dash is greater than, similarly this side also same thing, this is for I1 dash and R1, this one is for I1 and R1, and this one is for I1. Okay, this is the torque speed characteristics. So now we conclude one part. The braking torque depends on the equivalent stator current I1, which in turn depends on the magnitude of DC fed to the stator and the nature of conducts and the nature of stator winding connection. Another important point is the direct current, the DC, to be fed to stator for a particular connection is such that the magnitude of stator MMF before and after braking remains the same. So let us find out. So this is one important point for motoring. Let the stator current per phase be IAC. So before braking, stator MMF FAC is given by 3/2 times root 2 IAC into N1 is the stator number of turns per phase. Now for stator connection during braking, as shown in figure 1. So let us draw the figure. So this is the figure 1. So the DC supply is given to the stator for connecting it like this. So current supplied is IDC, and this is some resistance R external. So this MMF is N1 into IDC, and here also MMF is N1 into IDC. So resultant MMF FDC equals to root 3 times N1. So during braking, resultant MMF, which is FDC, is root 3 times IDC into N1. As for braking, FDC should be same as FAC just before braking. So we have FDC is root 3 IDC into N1. FAC is 3/2 root 2 times IAC into N1. So this implies for this circuit connection, IDC must be root over of 3/2 times IAC. So for this type of stator connection, the stator winding should be fed with a current IDC given by this expression. For stator connection during braking, as shown in figure 2, let us draw the circuit. This is the figure 2, this is the DC voltage, this is R external, and for this circuit connection, current in this winding is IDC, where DC is the current drawn from the DC source, and corresponding MMF is N1 times IDC, and current IDC divides to IDC by 2 and IDC by 2 in the two parts as shown here. So, corresponding MMFs will be N1 times. So, resultant MMF during breaking is FDC, that is IDC N1 plus 2 into 1 by 2 into N1 IDC by 2. So, this is 3 by 2 IDC N1. So, FDC equal to FAC requires, this is the condition that must be satisfied for dynamic braking, 3 by 2 IDC N1 equal to 3 by 2 into root 2 IAC into N1. So, this implies the DC current to be fed to the stator for this connection must be root 2 times IAC. So, the circuit connection can be different stator connection. So, for different stator connection, the supply voltage is selected and the external resistance is such that the appropriate value of DC current is IDC is fed to the stator, and condition satisfied must be satisfied before breaking the whatever the stator MMF was there, just after breaking the MMF should be also same, only MMF will be stationary to produce a breaking torque. Now, we will consider a delta connection of the stator winding to finding out the equivalent AC current and the DC excitation voltage and excitation power. So, let us consider delta connection of the stator winding like this. This is the delta connected stator winding. With this, we apply a DC voltage through a resistance to control the current. So, this current is IDC drawn from the DC source, and as you, this is figure 3, delta connected stator. So, in DC circuit, the windings offer only resistance, inductance will have no role. So, you can see we have one winding, say R1, the resistance of one winding is R1, other branch is 2R1, two windings are in series, so 2R1, R1 is resistance per phase. So, by and current entering into the circuit is IDC. So, by current division principle, here current in this branch will be 1 by 3 IDC, where the resistance is 2R1, where resistance is R1, current is 2 by 3 IDC. Now, this MMF carrying current 2 by 3 IDC is 2 by 3 IDC into N1. Then another one will have MMF in this direction, and another one will have MMF in this direction, and these two are each 1 by 3 IDC N1 both. This is also 1 by 3 IDC N1. So, with that, resultant MMF for the DC circuit FDC is, you see, 2 by 3 IDC N1 plus 2 into cos 60 degrees 1 by 2 into 1 by 3 IDC N1. So, this is IDC into N1. Because the constraint requires FAC should be equal to FDC, the MMF just before breaking and just after breaking should remain the same. So, FAC is 3 by 2 into root 2 IAC into N1, that is equal to IDC into N1. That means, IAC is root 2 by 3 into
IDC.
IAC root 2 by 3 into IDC. This is the equivalent stator current, IAC, equivalent RMS stator current. Q is this. So with that, what is the DC excitation voltage required? DC excitation voltage required, that is VDC. So that is effective resistance in this circuit into IDC. What is effective resistance? R1 and 2R1 in parallel. So R1 into 2R1 divided by R1 plus 2R1 is the effective resistance of the windings into IDC. So this is 2 by 3 R1 into IDC. And what is the excitation power? Excitation power required, that is VDC into IDC. VDC is the DC voltage applied and IDC is the current drawn from it. So multiplying, we have 2 by 3 R1 into IDC square. Let us relate it with IAC. Substituting IDC by IAC from the from this equation, we have excitation power is 2 by 3 R1 into IDC is 3 by root 2 IAC its square. So it is 3 R1 IAC square. That is obvious. If IAC is the RM equivalent RMS AC stator current per phase, then for three phases the excitation power is 3 R1 into IAC square. Let us consider another configuration of closed delta winding. Another circuit we will discuss, which is having two windings connected in delta and a V. That means third phase is out. Two phases are connected and in a closed V. Third phase is not there. And we apply DC voltage VDC. And it supplies the current IDC. So obviously, current in both the branches will be same. This is IDC by 2, and this is also IDC by 2. So with that, so we have two MMFs like this. This is F1, another at 60 degree. This is also F1, where F1 is half of IDC into N1. So what is the resultant MMF? F DC, if you do this angle is 60 degree, so it is F1 plus half F1 cos 60 degree square plus F1 sin 60 degree, that is root 3 by 2 F1 square root over. So this is 3 by 2 F1 square plus 3 by 4 F1 square root over. So this is root 3 times F1, root 3 times F1. Because the equivalent AC MMF, FAC has to be equal to FDC. Now equating both, we have FAC is 3 by 2 root 2 IAC into N1 equal to FDC is root 3 N1. So we have IAC is IDC N1 into IDC, IDC by root 6. So this is the equivalent AC stator current, equivalent RMS AC stator current. Let us find out DC excitation voltage required. That is VDC, that is effective resistance into IDC. So effective resistance is half of R1 because 2R1 in parallel. So effective resistance is half R1 into IDC. So what is the excitation power? P equal to VDC into IDC. VDC is half of R1 into IDC. So it is half of R1 into IDC square. So this is equal to half of R1 substituting IDC by IAC, we have 6 IAC square. So this is 3 R1 IAC square. From this we can see whatever may be the circuit configuration, excitation power in terms of equivalent RMS AC starter current is always 3 R1 into IAC square. In terms of DC quantities, it is VDC into IDC. And VDC is nothing but IDC into effective resistance of the winding. So this way we can find out the DC excitation voltage required and corresponding DC relation between DC and AC currents and also the excitation power required. Okay, thanks for the attention.